How are you?
It's good to see everybody. It's nice to be back. I want to take a moment to just thank Theo Bob, Pastor Theo, for coming last week. And he's an awesome man of God and always a joy to have him here. I know you've all enjoyed him very, very much. I always enjoy listening to him. I just love to sit and talk with him. So very thankful that he could come. As many of you know, myself and Meredith and a team of us from here at the church went up to Chicago to Harvest Bible Chapel over in Rolling Meadows, Illinois. A big, huge church. They had a conference up there, and it was an amazing, amazing weekend. God met us there in a powerful way and totally wrecked us all completely, just totally floored. And I think that's why Mike was having trouble tonight, right? You heard him a couple weeks ago when he came up here and did announcements, right? Wham, wham, ram, right? He hasn't been able to talk since we got back. Like, he was floored. He was floored. I'm just messing with you. He did a great job. But it was an amazing week, and I feel very, very refreshed. And the whole time I was there, I was taking it all in, but I was excited to come back and to meet with you all and share God's word with you. And that's what I want to do tonight. I want to thank the band for being our tour guides up the mountain of God and getting to meet with the Lord and to sing to Him. He's worthy of our songs and our time and our focus. And so I'm very thankful for them as well. I wanted to just let you know that things are progressing here at our church as far as the actual building itself. We're getting closer and closer to completion. We are open and functional, but there's still some things that we need to do. So be aware that there'll be some days that we'll announce to you. If you keep up with us on Facebook, you'll see that there'll be some days that we're going to ask that you can come in and help out, and we'll do some finish work up here just to get the place finished up. But the place is amazing, and I'm grateful that the Lord has allowed us to be here, a place where we can meet with Him. He can meet with us, and we can meet with each other. And so that's what this place is all about. So if you wouldn't mind, go ahead and grab a copy of God's Word. There's plenty of them around you. If you have your own, that's awesome. If you don't, there's plenty of Bibles here and there all around the church in the seat back in front of you. There's some on the tables. Go ahead and grab one of those. You may choose to use one of your digital devices. That's totally fine too. Please, if you're using your phone as a Bible, please, that's awesome. If you're not using your phone as a Bible, let's do this. Let's get rid of the phone and let's give God our complete attention. Okay, let's get Bibles out. Let's get notebooks out. Let's get pens in hand. Let's get phones turned off. And let's give the Lord our absolute attention and focus here tonight. There's a lot of things you could do, but you chose to do this. And so we want to make sure that your time here is profitable, right? So please open up your Bible to Luke chapter 6. We started a series some weeks ago, preaching through the Gospel of Luke, because Jesus Christ wants to build His church. We want to partner with Him to build His church. This isn't my church. This isn't your church. This is Jesus Christ's church, and He's building His church, and the Scriptures say that the gates of hell will not prevail. It's going to be built. It's going to win. It's going to grow, and we want to be a part of that, and He told us how we could partner with Him. He said that if we will lift up the name of Jesus, that Jesus would draw people to Himself and His church would build. And so we endeavored to do that by preaching through the Gospel of Luke, because the Gospel of Luke, from cover to cover, that's what Luke did. He spent all of his time teaching us who Jesus is, what He actually taught, what He did, who He was, right? Not hearsay, not gossip, not he said, she said, but what the Bible says about Jesus, and that's what we want to do. And so we've been preaching through the Gospel of Luke. And the reason why we're preaching through the Gospel of Luke is because God said that He wants His people, not everybody will, but He wants His people to worship Him in spirit and in truth. And so He wants us to release our emotions and our feelings, like really get in the spirit of worshiping Him. Like we wanna jump. You might see me jumping around over there like a crazy, going, "What's wrong with that guy?" Right? It's because I love Jesus. That's why I do it. Right? So maybe you all can maybe do a little bit of that jumping and dancing too. Right? But we want to release all those emotions and feelings that God has put inside of you towards someone or something that's worthy, and that's Him. And so we want to learn some truth so we can fire up the Spirit, right? That's why we're preaching through the Gospel of Luke, and that's where we're going to be tonight in Luke chapter 6. So here's the thing. In Luke chapter 6, there's two ways we can look at this text that we're going to be in tonight. And there's a bird's eye view, way up high, looking kind of down over the whole thing. You know, you get up way high on a plane, right? Anyone do it? Any traveling? You get up high on a plane and you can just see as far as the eye can see, just real far. You can see a lot when you're up there, right? Kind of a broad look of the whole area. And so we can look at that. We're going to look at it that way. I mean, there's also down on the ground, down on the nitty gritty, you know, down on the earth, down in the dirt. And we're going to look there as well, because God does want us to worship Him in truth, right? We need to have some truth so we can be fired up in our spirit. And so the truth of who Jesus is and what He does, it'll definitely fan the flames of Spirit-filled worship. When the reality of who Jesus is and the power in His hand and the power in His voice and the love in His heart and the authority of Jesus Christ, when that falls down on top of you, you can't help but worship Him, right? So we want that, but we also need to know the truth of what He teaches. And the reason why we need to know the truth of what He teaches is because oftentimes when we hear what He teaches, we will know if we're included in that group of His people that worship Him in spirit and truth. You following me? What He teaches will clarify whether you're in that family or not. And so we want to do that as well tonight. So all those in favor of building Jesus Christ's church, please put your eyes on Luke chapter 6, and we're going to start in verse 27. This is a familiar text. I've preached through this section of Scripture many times with different angles, often in the 6 years of this church, but some fresh eyes. Why don't we pray for that right now? Let's pray for some fresh eyes. You guys want to do that? All right, let's bow for a moment. Let's pray. Father, I thank You for this opportunity to come back to my family, whom I love, and to share Your precious word with them. Lord, as I've been praying this week and I share with my family, I know, Lord, that although this message may be a little bit shorter in length than norm, Lord, I pray that it has no shortage of power to transform lives. So, Lord, I pray that You will be in every single word, that Your heart would go forth, and that lives would be changed. Lord, this is a section of Scripture many of us have read many, many times, and we have this natural propensity to get to a section and just go, "Well, I've read that, and it's no big deal. I could skip over that, skim over that thing, and I've heard this before." But Lord, I pray that You'd give us fresh eyes to see something new here in the text that maybe we've never seen before. Help us to meet You right here in this section of Scripture. We don't want to just hear about You. We want to hear You. So give us fresh eyes, give us fresh ears to hear. We thank You in Jesus' name. So let's go ahead and read this right now. I'm going to read through verse 36. I'm reading in the New Living Translation. If you have a digital device and you might want to switch it to that just so you can understand what I'm saying to you. But King James is cool too. If you can understand it, that's good. I'm not that smart. Okay, so here we go. First of all, love for enemies, like that's not divine. That's not divinely inspired. That's man's effort to identify a section. So let's just throw this thing out, okay? Let's listen to the word. Verse 27, "But to you who are willing to listen," Jesus speaking, "I say, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who hurt you. If someone slaps you on one cheek, offer the other cheek also. If someone demands your coat, offer your shirt also. Give to anyone who asks, and when things are taken away from you, don't try to get them back. Do to others as you would like them to do to you. If you love only those who love you, why should you get any credit for that? Even sinners love those who love them. Side note, stop calling yourself sinners. I learned this recently. Okay? Stop calling yourself sinners. You're people who sin. You're not a sinner. Do you understand that? You read that. Okay. All right. So saints, are you hearing me?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, right, 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 yeah. So even sinners do that. And if you do good only to those who do good to you, why should you get credit? Even sinners do that much. And if you lend money only to those who can repay you, why should you get any credit? Even sinners will lend to other sinners for a full return. Love your enemies. Do good to them. Lend to them without expecting to be repaid. Then, so all of that right there that you just heard, wrap that up into the summary word of then, if you do that stuff, your reward from heaven will be very great, and you will truly be acting as children of the Most High, for He is kind to those who are unthankful and wicked. You must be compassionate, just as your Father is compassionate. All right. In May, I turned the key to this place, and I walked in the door to a big empty room. And so began the process of people coming together and gathering material to build. And I have to just tell you that, and if you've worked with me in this physical labor, you know that I know nothing about building. Every mistake that you see in the walls and on the floors and everything, you know that Moses built it. I am a let's get it done guy, and if it needs to get done, it gets done wrong, but it's done, okay? That's just the way I am. But I learned a lot about building that I never knew before. I learned a little bit about drywall, and I learned a little bit about framing, and I learned a little bit about plumbing, and I learned a little bit about this and a little bit about that. One of the things that I learned, and maybe you might know this, is when you're framing, that not all wood gets used. So sometimes you can go to the store and you need to, we would have to do that. We'd have to get big loads of 2x4s and such, and we'd have to bring them here to the church, and we'd have to build our walls. So that whole thing of walls there, that little compound in that area, that was nothing there. We had to build all that. We built that. We built a lot of walls. And so we had to go to Home Depot often to get wood. Well, sometimes, you know, when you go to Home Depot, you'll see, if you ever go there, you'll see men and women, contractors and such, and they'll need to go get some wood, and they'll start unpiling it off the pile, and you'll see them doing this. You know what I'm talking about? You know, they're checking to see. Let me see. Paul, is this one good? What do you think? Is that good? It's good there, right? How about this way? Is that good? Not bad. Not bad, right? Not bad. Pretty good, right? This is what we do. This one's a good piece of wood, right? We can use that, all right? But sometimes, you know, you get to the pile, and it might look good, but sometimes it's not very good. You see this canoe right here? Anyone want a banana? Because here it is. You don't want to know what's really funny? This piece of wood was more expensive than that one. This is pressure treated wood, but look at that thing. Whoa, right? You're not going to use this one, are you? See, not all wood is good to build. And a moment ago, we talked about Jesus Christ building His church, and He needs some good material to build it. Not all wood is going to work. Some of it is crooked and warped and busted and no good, and it's not going to be used, right? Not all wood gets into the building. And so you see, in Matthew 7:14, Jesus says something, and you need to take heed to this. He says that the gateway to life is very narrow, and it's difficult, and only a few will find it. See, we go to the store, right? Big pile of wood. This one's in. This one's in, right? We determined this one was good, right? But this one right here, he's not going to find his way into the house, is he? Because it's all jacked up. See, not all wood makes it into the build. You see, and so he says, listen, not everyone's going to make it in. The road is narrow, and only a few find it. And here's another one. It's difficult. It's hard. It's not easy, right? So, so, So some people think that they get into God's family. They get into be a part of the bride, a part of the body of Christ, the ones who are going to have glory someday in heaven with the Lord. Some think that they find their way down this narrow road by exercising religious traditions. And I go to church, and I'm going to take communion, and I got baptized, and I said the sinner's prayer. I've looked. And I've looked in the Bible. I've never seen the sinner's prayer here. Right? Never. I've never seen it. Now, certainly we need to pray. But I've never seen the sinner's prayer in Scripture. Some of us think that we get there because we believe. And although you do have to believe, we can't stop there. And stick with me now. Because everyone in church hears this all the time in this culture that wants things right now, right now, right now. Make it easy, make it quick. We got to get the numbers up. We got to get people in the church. We want to get the numbers up so it looks like we're making progress. Just because you believe in God, that doesn't mean that you're part of that family. James chapter 2, verse 19, James says this, that even the demons believe. Even the Satan's little homies that are going around, the ones who are in your life every day that are wrecking your world, and you let them, and I let them, those little demons believe. It goes so far that not only do they believe, it says that belief is so strong that it manifests itself in them physically, and they tremble in fear. They really believe in Jesus. But that belief, although it's strong, does nothing in them to make them want to lovingly, in faith, do something for the Lord. They don't, but they believe. And so that's why James goes on to say that faith in us without good deeds is dead. It's dead. You can believe all you want, but if something doesn't happen as a result, useless. See, there has to come a point that when you're reading this stuff, that this Word of God from cover to cover that's filled with the miracles of God and the instructions of God and the glory of God proclaimed to all of you, that sometime, at some point, this has to make you move. It's got to make you move. Something has to happen beyond what's happening right now. And if it moves you, that doesn't mean you're done. You move again. And every time you meet the Lord in his word, you move again. And you're never ever there. The finish line is there, but it moves every time you do. You keep moving. You keep moving. There has to be some type of a move. So the bird's eye view of Christianity is this. It's up high. It's right there in the first sentence of what we read. But to you who are willing to listen. See, that's a big one. Jesus is talking to you. And he's saying that some of you are willing to listen to me. And what's that also mean? That some of you are not. Some of you are not willing to listen to me. So the question is, who is he referring to here? When he says, who are the willing ones? Who are these ones that are willing to listen? It's super, super important. Probably, I would just venture to say this is just as important as anything I've ever said from this stage. Who are the willing ones? John chapter 10, one of my favorite sections of Scripture. You'll hear some similar language. But in John chapter 10, Jesus is elaborating in detail the difference between true, authentic disciples of Jesus, the true followers of Jesus, and then the false followers, the ones who are not authentic and real. He says that there are some that find the narrow path, and there are some that just flat out won't. And churches are filled with declarations of faith, but very few displays of faith. Come on now, right? It's true. It's true. So in John chapter 10, when Jesus is explaining this, you get to verses 4 and 5. Listen up now. God has your full attention, right? Yes. Jesus says this, my sheep, listen up now, my sheep follow me. because they hear my voice and they follow me. But they don't follow the voice of a stranger. Anyone that they don't recognize, they won't follow that. They'll only follow the Lord. And listen, you got to know, this is huge. My sheep follow me. It just to clarify, it doesn't say my sheep should. And it doesn't say my sheep often do. What does it say? My sheep follow me. They do as I say. They say as I do. That's this. They when I say jump, they do it. They don't even say how high. They just jump. Right? My sheep hear my voice and they follow me. They don't follow the voice of any other thing or any other one. There's only one voice that my sheep choose to obey. Jesus said you can't serve two masters. The Bible also says that whoever you choose to obey becomes your master. So the one who God gave all authority in heaven and earth, Jesus Christ, has now passed on that little bit of authority to you individually to make the choice to decide who is the voice you will follow. You have that choice. You have that choice. And no one can make it for you. Only you can do that. My sheep follow me. And so I am painfully aware, having done this for many, many years now, that as I stand before you right now and preach my little heart out the truth of God's word, some of you have determined in your heart right now that you will listen to this word and you will endeavor to live under its authority. And some of you are flat out refusing right now. I know you are. You're saying, I have no intention of actually doing what this says, but I'm here. Give me a cookie, right? Some of you have chosen that. Even now, we'd have a hard heart. We'd be rebellious. We'd be stubborn. We'd be lazy. You can call it a lot of different things. Prideful, maybe. But whatever you want to call it, you are willfully enslaved to the voice of another. That's the bottom line. You guys know I'm not going to hold back and like tell you how awesome you are and how great of everything's, you know, that's just not the way it is. You know, going through the Bible, here it is. Here's the next section. Can't dodge, can't duck. We just got to tell you the truth. And so some of us will willfully be enslaved to the voice of another. That we're not going to come to church and come in here and have the preacher say, open the Bible, and you're going to open the Bible, and you're either, well, maybe you won't even open the Bible. That's blatant rebellion. But maybe you'll open the Bible and just go, you know what, I hear it, but I'm just not going to do that. You know, I got my way. There's a guy named A.W. Tozer. He's probably my absolute favorite. I could just listen to this man all day, and I think it's because he was a pastor in Chicago back in like the 50s. He was his spine was a redwood, and I'm sinfully jealous of his boldness. You pray for me, but I love to listen to this man speak because he's dead now. You can't say anything to him, so I look forward to that day. I'm gonna be dead soon, and I can just say whatever I want, right? So here's what A.W. Tozer says on this issue. I want ears to hear. You ready? Millions call themselves by his name, it is true, and pay some token homage to him. But a simple test will show how little he is really honored among them. Let the average man be put to the proof on the question of who or what is above, and his true position will be exposed. Let him be forced into making a choice between God and money. Let him be forced into making a choice between God and men. Let him be forced to making a choice between God and personal ambition. Let him be forced into making a choice between God and self. Let him be forced into making a choice between God and human love, and God will take second place most often. Those other things will be exalted above. However the man may protest, the proof is in the choices he makes day after day throughout his life. That's truth. Hammer. But it's true. And I'm telling you, I live that. I'll be the first to admit it. I live that. See, I think in our world today, we desire so badly to get things done so quickly. You know, we have all these different devices that try to manage our time and get as much in crammed in one day as we can. And I'm guilty of it too. So So I say that because in my life, and probably in yours too, there's been times where someone has taught you how to evangelize. You know, they have evangelism training. I've taught this, so I'm guilty. I want to tell people about my faith, but I'm just not confident, right? I don't really know what to say, and I don't know if I know how to preach that. And to, you know, so you're insecure about it, and you're not sure, and I get that. So you go to this evangelism training class, right? And I've been to the class, and I've taught the class, and we teach the Romans Road. Anyone ever heard of the Romans Road? Raise your hand. Anybody? Okay, so let me just, for the majority of the room doesn't know what Romans Road is. The Romans Road are verses in the book of Romans where the person, like you, can just go to someone, open up the Bible, and take them through the Romans scripture verses, and basically what it'll do is it'll outline to that person, hey, look at this verse. This verse shows you that you're a sinner, that God's got commandments, and you, did you ever steal anything? Yeah. Did you ever lie to anybody? Yeah. Okay, well then you're a lying cheater and a killer and a murderer, right? So that's what they make you feel like, total crap. And so if you broke one commandment, you broke them all, and so you are in no place to save yourself. So it makes everyone feel low, and rightfully so, because God's law makes us guilty before Him. Every single person is guilty before a perfect and holy God. I get that. So we start there. And then after that, I'll take you to another verse that says, listen, you don't have to get cleaned up before you come to the Lord, because Romans 5:8 says He shows great love by sending Jesus to die for you while you're a sinner. So you're like, oh, great, so I'm a lying, cheating thief and a jerk and a loser and a murderer, but Jesus loves me, and so I'm good, right? And so then He says, well, and if you just do this, Romans 10:9, it's the end of the Romans Road, right? And I've skipped a few verses, but the end of the Romans Road is this. Romans 10:9, you land there. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you'll be saved. And listen, that is totally, totally true. Absolutely true. If you confess this, yes. If you believe it, yes, it's true. But listen, loved ones, I want to confess something to you. Did you guys know that I have $1 million? No, seriously, not only do I have $1 million, but did you guys also know that I'm the number one chess player in the world? Well, not only do I have $1 million, I'm the number one chess player in the world, but I also have a master's degree from Harvard in bioengineering and nanotechnology. I have that. And it's 2016, so I'm a woman. Why are you laughing? I've confessed it with my mouth. Oh, and I believe it. You ask the people that say that, they believe it, right? But here's the truth. The truth is that I asked my wife today how much money we have. And she said, oh, about $200. I played chess twice last week. It was the first two games I've played since 2011. I was excited that I actually beat Meredith. I barely beat my 12-year-old. I'm not the best player in the world. And guess what? I'm either the ugliest woman who's ever lived, or the truth is that I'm a man. You see? So just because you confess something with your mouth, and even if you believe it, that doesn't mean that it is. And so even if you confess Jesus as Lord, sometimes it doesn't mean a whole lot, does it? Someone recently asked me, let me just say that being in ministry is difficult. It's time-consuming. When you're building stuff, it's labor-intensive. It's hard on your heart to talk to the people that you love and hear all the disaster in your lives. You know, like this is happening and that's happening, and it's hard. You know, and I'm saying it's very, very difficult. And I've had to go to the jail often to visit people that I love because they make just the most horrific choices. And end up, you know, in the big house, and marriages are falling apart, and there's drugs and drinking and all these different things, and you see all that, just, it's toxic in people's lives. Horrible choices end up in horrible situations because of those choices, and you're in that, and people are calling you and telling you about it all the time, but somebody did ask me recently about one of the most difficult things that a pastor has to deal with. And he asked me, he said, "If do you get frustrated when you, week after week, month after month, sometimes year after year, come to the church fully prepared, preach God's word to the same people, they hear it over and over again, and there's no move. There's no do. There's no change, right? Is it frustrating?" Oh. I can't frame words to describe that pain. I mean, I've 6 years for this church, but a lot longer than that, really. And I've known a lot of you for a long time, and it's like I'm not bragging on me. I'm just me. But I have there's a song, "I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of things." And I have personally tasted the goodness that comes in a transformed life. You see what I'm saying? Like I have experienced the joy of the Lord in the presence of Him. Right? I've enjoyed the blessing of open it, read it, do it. I've enjoyed the joy that comes when we actually do what the Lord asks of us. Right? I've seen the joy in that. I've experienced it on my own. And if I love you at all, I want that for you, right? And so it's painful to come in every week and see people do not change. When I say pick up the Bible, it's the greatest treasure that Almighty God has ever left us, and no one will pick it up. Like, I don't get that. I don't get. I've had people in this church. I don't know what you all give and all that kind of stuff. It's not my business. But there are people in this church that have stood before you and told you how they were so broke and nothing's working, and they began to give to the offering, right? And all of a sudden, God just did crazy awesome things in their life because of it. And yet, week after week, the basket goes by and it's like, oh no, buddy. Like, and it's not because anyone, God doesn't need your money. This church closed tomorrow. His church will be built. Do you see? But what He's trying to do with that offering basket is to free you, right? And we need to be freed. And so, yeah, it's very difficult for me to stand up here week after week, month after month, year after year, and see that. And I have to say also the other side of that coin is that especially as of late, I've seen some awesome transformation in some of you, and that is really encouraging to my heart. It makes me want to get back in the game, you know what I'm saying, when I see that. So I'm excited about that. But here, listen, this is the amazing thing about God. Listen, so He's got this big, awesome book, right? And it starts here in Genesis, and He's talking about the greatness of God and the mercies of God and the miracles of God. And here's the teaching of the Lord and the commands of the Lord, the law of the Lord, all these tremendous stories about God's delivery of His people, right? His faithfulness and His love and His power, all this kind of stuff. And when you get all the way towards the end of the book, almost to the very end, you get to the book of James, and James says, listen, all this stuff, don't just hear it. Don't just hear the word, but you must do the word. Like, you can't just come to church and hear it, but you got to do what it says. And then it goes on to say, or else, this is awesome. Don't just hear it, right? You're hearing it? Am I loud enough? Okay. Someone said that Spirit-filled preaching is the power of God preaching the word of God through the man of God. So you're hearing it, right? Yes. He says, if you must do it, or else you're only fooling yourself. I'm a Christian. Really? Well, I believe. Okay. Are you doing it? It says if you're not doing it, you're fooling yourself. You know what I'm saying? And that's a problem. That's a massive problem. Well, I just, you know, I go to church a few times a month, and I'm doing better than I was before, and I do lots of good stuff, and thank God that you are doing better. But listen, Jesus said to go forth and make disciples of all people, teaching them to obey, here's the word, all, say all, all that I have taught you. And that's what I'm endeavoring to do every single week. He gives me something. I'm trying to be faithful to share with you so that you might not hear it, but you might obey all of it. That's the goal here when you come to church. It's not just to listen, but it's to actually submit yourself under the authority of God's word and go, you know what? I'm doing that. And guess who has the authority to do that? Raise your hand. Because it's you. God has given you the authority that is solely His. He gave it to you so you could make a choice as to what voice you will follow. No one can make that choice for you. You have to do it. And so, Revolution, I just want to tell you, you got to examine your heart. I can tell you that I want to be a part of a church that's, man, not just a... I don't want it to be filled up with people that are hearing me. I want it to be filled up with people that are hearing the Lord and doing what He says. But can you imagine that? That would be awesome. Yes. That's the kind of church anyone else want? Listen, yes. Show of hands. Let's take a vote. It's election time, right? That's the kind of church I want to have. I want to be in that family. I want to be in that family. So do you desire to honor and please God with everything you think, everything you say, everything you do? Do you long to come in and hear God's word proclaimed over you and long to obey what it says? Do you earnestly pursue holiness? Are you ravenously pursuing purity? And if you're not, like if you are, that's awesome, but how many of us will fail in that? James says we all fail in many ways. So are you earnestly pursuing these things? Yes, right? But when you do and you make a mistake, are you repenting? Are you repenting? Are you exercising the gift that God gave to you to repent of your sin and be forgiven of that sin and to be cleansed of all unrighteousness, 1 John 1:9. Forgive the sins and cleanse you of all the yuck and the guilt that you feel because you broke His rule. He'll cleanse you of all that. Are you exercising repentance and then digging your heels in afresh to do better next time? Are you doing that? Or are you just coming to church? The bird's eye view of the worldwide church, the capital C, is that it's filled with people who have made Jesus their Savior for life eternal. But very few are willfully submitting to the authority of Christ's Lordship. You see. And it's amazing because none of us want to take responsibility for ourselves. I know that. I mean, we're all a bit like that, I'm sure, to some extent. See, when you trust Jesus as Savior, it's your trusting in what Jesus has done. It's what Jesus did to get you there, right? But Lordship's different. That's trusting in what you do to make Him Lord. You see the difference between the two? One is trusting in what He did for you, and the other one is what you need to do to make Him Lord. There's a big difference in that. There's a massive difference in that. And see, when you accept Jesus, you have to accept Him as both Lord and as Savior, like both. You can't just accept Him as Savior so that when you die, you get to fly off with the angels and all that stuff that we talk about and being captured up in the sky and I'm going to go be with Jesus, right? Here's the problem. Acts 2:36 says that God has made Jesus both Lord and Christ. The same word Christ is translated deliverer, Messiah, and Savior. He has made Jesus both Lord and Savior. And so if you want Jesus, you got to have all of Him. You can't choose one or the other. You see? And so if Jesus, listen, I'm going to tell you this. If Jesus is not your Lord by your choice of actions, then He is not your Savior. And I love you enough to tell you the truth. Okay, and there's grace in that. He knows you're going to fail. You raised your hand when I said that. We all fail in many ways. When you mess up and you break one of the rules, he's not going, man, I can't believe that. He's out. Remember Kramer? I'm out, Jerry. Right? That's not the way God is. God has some grace. Don't take advantage of it. But he's got some grace. So if he's going to be Lord, he's got to be Savior. If he's going to be Savior, he's got to be Lord. And Jesus teaches. He teaches a parable. He shares a parable in Matthew chapter 13. Please go there. He shares a parable there that is frightening. Everyone wants to hear about the grace of God and the goodness of God and the love and fuzzies of God. I love that too. But God is a multifaceted diamond, right? Yes. There's a lot to him. We're going to make sure we get the whole God. And if we're going to worship him in spirit, we need to have some truth, right? Yes. We got to have some truth. Can someone do me a favor? We're working on lights and we're going to get better, but can someone go back and switch? There's two sets of light switches back there. If you could go around that corner and there's a set of light switches there, click the two middle ones. You can't, it's too dark. You can't even see your Bibles. I'm so sorry. But we're working on it. But I think by this time next week, we'll probably be finished with the lighting in here. There you go. Is that better? Now you can read your Bibles. Awesome. Thank you, whoever that was. Love you. Okay, so Matthew 13, look at verse 24. Here's Jesus teaching on this exact subject. And listen, ears to hear. Listen, you ready? Verse 24. Here's another story that Jesus told, a parable of Jesus Christ. It's in red. God has your full attention. Here we go. The kingdom of heaven is like a farmer who planted good seed in his field, but that night as the workers slept, his enemy came and planted weeds among the wheat and then slipped away. When the crop began to grow and produce grain, the weeds also grew. The farmer's workers went to him and said, "Sir, the field where you planted that good seed is full of weeds. Where did they come from?" And Jesus says, "An enemy has done this." He's the farmer, right? And so they ask, "Should we pull out the weeds?" That's a normal question, right? You see weeds in your garden, you're going to rip them up, right? But Jesus says, "No. You'll uproot the wheat if you do that. Let both grow together until the harvest. Then I will tell the harvesters to sort out the weeds, tie them into bundles." This is scary. "And burn them, and to put the wheat in the barn." So some of the garden is going to go into the barn, like glory, right? Do you see that? Do you see it in the text, right? And some are going to get burned. We know where that is, right? We see that in the text. Okay, so it's very clear. But there's some question in that. And so the disciples are wondering. So if you jump down to verse 36, Jesus will begin to explain the story he just told. Are you ready for an explanation? Okay. So Jesus says that he leaves the crowds outside and he went into the house and his disciples said, "You know, explain this story to us." Okay, and I'm there. I want to know. So Jesus says this, "The Son of Man," and that's what he called himself, "is the farmer who plants the good seed. The field is the world. And the good seed represents the people of the kingdom." Okay, so if you're a believer, this is who he's talking to. You're the good seed, the people of the kingdom. But the weeds are the people who belong to the evil one. This is Satan, the devil. So you see in that same garden, there's those that belong to Christ and there's those that belong to Satan. And then the harvest is the end of the world. So there's that day of the Lord coming, right? Where we all have to face the Lord. And the harvesters that he referred to in that story are the angels. So we have all the characters in place, right? You got all the characters to the story in place. Now we'll begin to unpack what the story is about. He says, "Just as the weeds are sorted out and burned in the fire," this is scary, "so it will be at the end of the world. The Son of Man, Jesus Christ, will send his angels and they will remove from his kingdom everything that causes sin and all who do evil, and the angels will throw them into the fiery furnace where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in their Father's kingdom." Listen, this is familiar. "Anyone with ears to hear, should listen and understand. Have you heard something similar to that just a moment ago, right? Anyone with ears to hear should listen. And so what Jesus is telling us here in this parable is that you can walk into any church in the world, including the one you sit in right now, and you will find wheat and you will find weeds. And they all look the same. They'll do this. They'll do this. They'll put money in the plate. There's weeds and there's wheat. And they're growing together. It's those weeds that will one day say, Lord, Lord, we prophesied in your name. We cast out demons in your name. We performed miracles in your name. We ate and drank with you, Lord, and you taught in our streets. You came close to us. We had some proximity. Remember when you were playing tag when you were a kid? Electricity. One's on base. And if you touch them, you're in. And some people feel that way about Jesus. Like, he got close. We got to the church. We heard what you said. You taught in our streets. You didn't just teach over there in Eustace. No, you came right here and you were teaching right here. Which is what I'm doing right now. And he looks at those people and he says, I never even knew you. Right? That should stir you up a little bit. I never knew you. So you listened to some of my teaching and you did lots of stuff. I get that. But did you do your stuff and slap my name on it? Or did you do my stuff? See, this is a big difference. I've been in churches where the most ungodly behavior you will ever see is happening, and they slap the Holy Spirit on it. And nowhere in the Bible will you find what they did, but they put his name on it. And Jesus is like, yeah, you did lots of stuff in my name, but did you do my stuff? Right here. Did you do my stuff? You got to ask yourself that. So the bird's eye view is really an overall lethargy, a complacency, a stubbornness, a willful rebellion, a fingers in the ears, blah, 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 blah. I'm not listening to you, Lord. Salvation proclaimed and obedience abstained. If you look at the next column over on the same page in Luke 6, over in verse 46, Jesus says, why do you call me Lord, Lord, but you don't do what I say? Proclaiming with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, let me tell you something, and I don't want to be blasphemous. It's meaningless if there's no substance behind it. Do you understand? Why do you call me Lord, Lord, if you don't do what I say? I've said this before, I'll say it again. If you have, who works for a living here? Who works for a living and has a boss? Come on, John, put your hand up, Dan. She's like, that's right. That's right. I just keep it up. I don't even have a point. I just wanted to see it. Yeah. All right, so let's go on to the next chapter. No, I'm just kidding. So let me ask you a question. Those who have a boss, if your boss told you what to do and you didn't do it, like 50 times, would he still be your boss?
No.
Probably not. What if you had a really lenient boss? Maybe, you know, it's Christmas time, you know, it's the holidays, and they're feeling really charitable and all that kind of stuff, and maybe he gives you a little slide. So if your boss tells you what to do and you don't do it 100 times, is he still going to be your boss? Why do you call me Lord, Lord, if you won't do what I say? I mean, I'm preaching to the choir. I mean, you guys don't have to be here. I'm terrible. I'm just... The wonderful thing about God's word is that it's truth no matter who it's coming from. Amen? Right? That's awesome. Thank God. Thank God. Those with ears to hear. Those who are willing to listen. So the question I asked you at the beginning was this. Who are the willing? And the answer is true believers. True believers hear his voice and obey him. I mean, I didn't make anything up, right? I know it's not fuzzy. I'm sorry. No, I'm not. It's the truth. It's the truth, and I love you, and I want to share the truth with you. So that's the bird's eye view. It's this that broad brush of listen, I'm going to say a lot of different things, and those who are willing to listen, they need to follow me. And there's a lot of not listening. They're hearing it, but we're not doing it, and James addresses that. You know, like, don't just hear it, but do it, or you're just fooling yourself. And I don't want to have a church that's fooling themselves. I want to be filled up with authentic followers of Jesus Christ. We're shooting for a quality of discipleship, not so much a quantity of. The ideal, the sweet spot of God is a quality and a quantity all meeting for the perfect storm. That would be awesome, right? That's what we're shooting for. Okay, so, but here's the second view of this same text I told you a little bit ago was down on the ground, like down in the dirt, right? The nitty-gritty where the rubber meets the road, the brass tacks of obedience to the Lord. And so we see this in verse 35 of this text. It says that all these different things we should do and shouldn't do, he says, then your reward from heaven will be very great and you will be truly acting as children of the Most High. See, that's what a disciple of Jesus is, right? The one who's actually doing as Jesus did. We see his example, we willfully obey it. And so that's what he says there. Here's the things that you do, and if you do this, then you're truly acting as the Lord. And so it's a question of lordship. Okay, so it takes us right down to the ground. So what I want to do is I don't want to necessarily read this whole section again to you because I want to kind of finish up here, but I just want to remind you of the highlights. Because we just started out by saying, listen, we're supposed to obey him, right? He said, if you're willing to hear, obey me, right? And if you're really a Christian, you're going to hear what I say, and you're going to do what I say, right? That's what, do you all agree to that? Okay, so I'm not making anything up. So he tells us to love our enemies. That's a broad brush. What does that mean? Well, I don't really know. And so God's word is faithful to us, and it goes in deeper, so it'll tell you what that looks like. Well, do good things to those who hate you. Like, do good to them, the ones who hate you. Bless those that curse you. Now listen, you're thinking about someone yet? I mean, I'm only maybe a third of the way through the list. You're thinking about somebody? Raise your hand if you're thinking about somebody. Come on. Okay. At least half of you are thinking, well, we're going to get you in the next one. How about this one? Pray for those that hurt you. Come on now. Right? If someone slaps you in your cheek, offer the other one. That doesn't mean this one. Right? I know we have four. I think the implication is this one, right? Not this one. I'm just saying. Give to anyone who asks. That I was taught this weekend in Chicago that if the text, this he's talking to preachers, if the text grips you, you'll preach gripping. And this gripped me. Listen. I'm not telling you what to do, okay? I'm going to offer something to you. I don't know what's going to pop into your head when I say this, but listen. Give to anyone who asks. You thinking about anything right now? It doesn't say what, and it doesn't say who. It says give to anyone who asks. It's not a suggestion. That gripped me. Because I'm thinking back of all the times that I've rationalized and I've logicked my giving away. When someone needed something, well, you know, I just got to be a good steward of my money and I've got to be discerning. I don't know that you have to be discerning of something God's specific about. Does anyone in the room have to be discerning about thou shalt not kill? Do you got to think about that one, you know? Yeah, I know I says I'm not supposed to do that, you know, but I just think I'm going to kill that guy, you know? And we laugh, right? But give to anyone who asks. It gives me a fresh look, and I talk about fresh eyes. It gives me a fresh eyes towards the guy on the side of the road. And I think, you know, he's probably just going to drink. Who cares? Give to anyone who asks. Well, if I give it all away, I'm not going to have anything. Well, maybe your obedience will provide blessing for you. Just saying, right? I'm just throwing it out there. You can do what you want with it. You do what you want. So I started thinking about all these things that love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those that hurt you. Someone slaps your cheek, give them the other one. I think Jesus got slapped and turned the other cheek. Could have called down legions of angels to get him off that cross, couldn't he? But he didn't. He let him slap, spit, spike, kill. Right? When he was about to die on the cross in his flesh, what did he say? Forgive them, Father. They know not what they do. He prayed for people who were cursing him and hating him, his enemies. And give to anyone who asks. How about this? Romans 3:22. We are made right with God by placing our faith in Jesus Christ. And this is true for everyone who believes, no matter who we are. Romans 10:13. Everyone, someone say everyone. Everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And we don't like that. That kind of rubs us the wrong way. For those of us who have been following Jesus for a long time, and we're like, man, we did this and we did that, but we paid our dues, Lord. And that wretched piece of crap, he's on his deathbed, and he says, he confesses that Jesus is Lord, and he gets to go to heaven with me? You're darn right he does. Because that's what it says. It says to give to anyone who asks. And Jesus has said to everyone across the earth that lies and cheats and hated me, I died for you. Just say yes and you're in. Like that's who he is. It's for everybody. So when I see this list, it's like this it's a reminder that the road is narrow and it's difficult. And right, that's the cross. That's the cross. He endured the shame of the cross for the joy set before him. And this joy set before us, if we will endure the cross, like him, he said that, right? If you want to be my follower, pick up your cross. That's it right there. Amen. That's it. That's the golden rule. It's all wrapped up. It's detailed, right? Do to others as you want them to do to others. We are so awesome at reciprocating, but we're terrible at initiating. That's us. We love. He says we'll love. If you love me, Paul, I will love you back. Well, that's admirable, but Jesus loved people who didn't love him. Well, we'll do for you if you do for me, right? You scratch my back and it's an American cliche, except it's garbage. Jesus is like, you never scratched my back. You whipped my back, and I gave it for you. That's what he did. He's an initiator of love. And that's who we're supposed to be, but it's difficult. So how's this list going for you? Because it's going horrible for me. I mean, I'm just going to tell you, it's going horrible. We need to pray for each other. Because churches, we're not like that, right? We're not initiators. We're reciprocators. That's just the way we are. Don't tread on me. The first half of the message that I'm bringing you is easy. It's a broad brush. It's way up above. It's like, yeah, I'm supposed to listen. It's this ethereal thinking, angelic, way up high. Yeah, I'm doing what God says to do. And then all of a sudden, he takes you down out of the plane. He puts you on the ground into the dirt. And he's like, I want you to bless those who curse you. It's like, man, I'm pulling back off of that one, man, right? He's ripping me publicly, and he's emasculating me, and he's ripping me down, and he's being mean to me, and he's taking things from me, and all these people, they're just, King David was like that all the time, you know, like, why are my enemies after me? And we're like that, like, things aren't going good. I don't want to do good for him. He's a jerk, and he's rotten. He's terrible to me. And listen, that's why the road's narrow and it's difficult and few find it, because it's hard. It's hard to be nice to that person. But listen, none of those people ever stuck you up on a cross and spit in your face and slapped you in the face and spiked you and killed you. And Jesus did it. And the same spirit that lives in him lives in you. You are able to do these things if you will endeavor by your will to do it. You can do it, but it's difficult. So will you do this? Well, most will not. That's the broad road, right? Most will not. And few will. That's the narrow road. It's been a long time since we've taken communion here at our church, and much to the negligence of your pastor. That's why we haven't taken. It's nothing spiritual. I am forgetful, and I didn't have the stuff. But tonight we get to do communion. And I hope that that it's a precious time for you. And I hope that we can reflect upon what we're sharing here tonight as we take communion. So what I'd like to do is, Robert, would you, and then would you come and help, please? Would you take a tray, please, and hand this out with him, please? That would be awesome. We call the band's going to come up, and they're going to help us worship the Lord. But I just want to remind you, that to call Jesus Savior, you have to call him Lord. And you can't just call him Lord. You have to act in a way that reflects your heart's condition, that he is your Lord. Okay? And in our culture today, in an effort to get through things quickly, make it simple and easy for everybody, I think we leave this lordship out. It's the neglect of the church, and I'm guilty of it. We're all guilty of it to a certain extent. But the lordship of Jesus is what will ensure you the salvation of Jesus. You get this? See, God's word says in 1 Timothy 2:4 that God wants everyone to be saved and to understand the truth. And so I've tried to share the truth with you tonight about the lordship of Jesus Christ. And the truth is that authentic Christians will hear his voice and they will follow him. They will obey the voice of Jesus Christ. And so you may hold on to the communion. We'll take it together as a family in a moment. But you may be thinking as I'm saying this to you that, you know, I haven't been obedient. I've read the word. I've listened to the preacher preach. I've heard the guy on the radio and the TV, and I know what I'm supposed to do, but I haven't. I haven't done it. So maybe it's just, maybe he wouldn't love me anymore. Maybe he wouldn't let me in anymore. Well, the scripture says in the Gospel of John that by no means will the Son refuse anyone who comes to him. That's a big, wide open door, isn't it? It also says in Psalm 51 that you will not reject a broken and repentant heart, O God. So, I'm going to take a moment, and the band's going to sing. And what I would ask you to do is not what we asked you to do earlier, which was sing with the band. Don't sing with the band. Just reflect. Take a few minutes to repent. You know, Lord, I hear the guy. I hear what he's saying. And I've heard your word tonight. I haven't lived up to that. Would you forgive me, Lord? Ask for forgiveness. Ask him to give you a new fresh power to be obedient to his word. So that we might be a church that's filled with people who are committing their will to the obedience of God's word. So take a moment as they sing, reflect on those things, and then I'll come back up and we'll take communion together as a family, okay? Well, I hope you've done the work of repentance. As the song says, his arms are open wide, ready to receive. And you can do that because of the precious blood of Jesus. And that's why we take communion. And the Bible talks about not taking this unworthily, and people in Christianity not quite sure what that means, but I will say this. Don't come to the altar without confessing your sins. Don't come into the presence of the King. Although you can come, he wants you to, but don't go in without confessing your sins. So I hope you've taken a few minutes to do that work, to get that done, and to say, I'm sorry. I've heard your word. I've read it. I've heard it preached, and I haven't obeyed. As a matter of fact, I've come in, and I've determined I'm just not really going to follow you. And I want to start fresh. I want to do better. So with that as our prayer, let's just take a moment to remember the Lord, the one who made this forgiveness and this entrance into the kingdom possible by giving of himself on the cross at Calvary. And the bread that you hold in your hand, it represents Christ's body that willfully, lovingly went to the cross on your behalf. And so as you take this bread right now, remember that. I'm just thinking this, a little taste of Jesus makes you thirsty for some more, doesn't it? Oh, that's good. And in your hand, you have this cup, and it represents God's signature on the contract of forever love and forgiveness for those who embrace His Son. And so that's what this cup is. And so why don't we take that drink right now to remember the Lord Jesus. We thirst and you quench our thirst. We it's evidence right there in this communion. Lord, I thank you for letting us draw close to you. And your word tells us that when we draw close to you, you draw close to us. And so, Lord, we sense in our spirit right now, even now, that you're here. As we have in our own hearts, in our minds, in our own inner voices, we've called out to you, and we've repented, and we've cried out to you for forgiveness, and you rush into the brokenhearted, and you're here with us right now. So Lord, we just thank you for coming and spending time with us and spreading your love out all over us, Lord. Thank you for that. So Lord, we want to bless you right now. We want to sing right now to you. I want to ask the church, I want to ask you to come to your feet, to honor the Lord Jesus and all that he has done and all that he is, and sing with your band right now. Sing with them. Sing to the Lord. Sing to the Lord and sing of his goodness and his mercy and his love. Sing to the Lord.